Good morning. Whoops. Hang on a sec. There we go. Good morning. It is good to have you here on this, the 5th of July, and glad that so many could join us this morning as we have our communion service together. So because I'm starting with announcements first, I'm going to show you how to open your communion elements. Because if you open it differently, then you got to figure out how to get the wafer out after you've got the juice exposed. Okay? So I know this sounds a little odd, but if you look at the top, you see this little pointy part? Don't start there, okay? That's the part that'll open up the juice. So if you start on the edge and just start peeling back like this, you'll notice there's a thin, clear plastic cover. You pull off that thin plastic cover and underneath it will be the wafer. Once you get the wafer out, then you can lift up the pointy part and peel it back. What's that? Oh, and yes, my wife wants me to remind you these are not gluten-free. So if you have issues with gluten, please bear that in mind, and we apologize ahead of time. This is our, right now, COVID-19 precautions, is that all of these are independently packaged, and you noticed they were on the table, so they weren't touching each other. So we will have this a little bit later together. If you want to start working on the edging to get the top part off, feel it, go ahead. I'm not feeling bad about that at all. And I will share that with us when we're going to get started. Thank you very much. So as we have been doing, we're going to start with the message, and then we'll go to communion, and then we'll have music afterwards. And according to the CDC, that when you sing, you're expressing and propelling a lot more than when you are just listening, and so therefore people might feel more comfortable leaving before the singing starts. So this morning, after I pray, we'll have the message, we'll have communion, then there will be a break with a little presentation on the video. And if you desire to leave at that point, just stand where you are during that intermission. Our usher will help escort you out so that you don't have to feel like you're bunching up, and then we'll continue on with the worship and music at the end of the service. There are two videos today. I just want you to know that. The first one will be during the time that we take communion together, and the second one will follow that, and that'll be the intermission video in the event that some feel it's best for them at this point with their health risks to leave this morning before we sing. We are here because we want to prayerfully build relationships so that we can impact lives with the transforming power of Jesus Christ for the growth of God's kingdom. This is what we're all about. Today we're going to talk about unity and the glory of God and how he gave that to us as his church. But in the news, as you get bombarded with all the negativity that's going on, not just in our world, our country, but also in the world, and unity doesn't seem to be a word that we're seeing much lived out. We're going to talk about how that meets us as believers and what we can do to respond to that. But first, let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for this glorious day, Lord. I thank you, Jesus, that in a little while that we are going to be able together as a church family to receive communion, to remember again the sacrifice that you made for us so that we might be redeemed from our sins, adopted into your family, and know that we will spend eternity loving and serving you. Thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice. Help us to understand, Lord, what that means for us during the here and now and what we're experiencing in our world. And I just invite you and ask you, Holy Spirit, to speak to us as individuals, first of all, but then corporately as a church body, that we would hear from the word of God today and apply your truth to our lives, that we will be a living demonstration of the glory of Jesus Christ. I just pray this in your name, O Lord. Amen. All right, so we are going to, first of all, I'm going to launch into the message. I need to correct two term definitions I made last week. I got them mixed up, and I hope I didn't mix you up. So I'm just going to clarify, okay? I apologize if it brought any confusion to you last week, so I'm going to correct it. You will recall that I emphasized three words last week in the beginning of the message: theology, doctrine, and dogmatic. Dogmatic, I got right. But I mixed up theology and doctrine, okay? So to clarify, doctrine is the foundational beliefs, the scriptural standards of our Christian faith. And I identify that as theology, and that's wrong. The foundations of our faith are things like the deity of Jesus Christ, the virgin birth, God as creator of the universe, the inspiration and authority of Scripture. Those are the doctrines, the standards of our Christian faith. No matter what Christian church you go into, those should never change. Theology is the proposed understanding of some of the doctrines. Let me give you an example. Theology would be like Arminianism and Calvinism, okay? And Calvinism is the belief that you are preordained, who's going to be a believer and who's not. Arminianism says anyone can come to faith in Christ. And then if you really want to get confusing, you can go to extreme or ultra Calvinism, where even the Calvinists say, wow, those are really, guys are really off base. And so you've got this within theology, not doctrine, okay? So I clarify that today because I'm talking about the unity and the glory of God. And I want to make sure that we understand the doctrine, if you will, of what God means for us in the area of unity. Jesus prays with scholars believe that when he prays the high priestly prayer, that he is talking about the unity of the church, which is all believers, as well as the glory of God given to the unity of the church. And we're going to look at that this morning. Now, if you look at John 17, your Bibles, there's more to this. I'm starting at verse 20, and there's a lot more. This is called the high priestly prayer. That's what scholars call it anyway. But I'm taking the second portion of that this morning, and that is the call for unity. Jesus says this: I do not ask on behalf of these alone, meaning the disciples, but for those also who believe in me through their word. In other words, everyone who testifies to be a follower of Jesus Christ, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The unique thing about the word believe here in the Greek is what it means is continually believe. In other words, not just for a moment, but they truly understand through the unity of God's people that Jesus was sent by God himself, the Father, to redeem people from their sins. Jesus is referencing all believers in verse 20. That means you and I. He's not speaking just directly on behalf of the disciples. He's not praying to the Father directly just for the disciples. He's talking about everyone that profess to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Jesus desires the same degree of unity that we see in the Godhead. Think about that. When you have an issue with a brother or sister in the faith, or when you and I might have an issue with people in our community that aren't believers, the Bible says that we as believers, when we express and exercise unity among one another, that unity should be so profound it has the same bearing as the unity between God the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's in verse 21. I and you, you and me, and them and us. That's what that's referring to. Unity must be maintained for continual belief. In a moment, if they see unity, it's great. Hey, I saw that in a person today. They did a marvelous thing. It was incredible the way they solved their issues between each other. But that should be ongoing, not just a moment of goodness, if you will. Jesus recognizes such unity convinces the world that Jesus Christ is God's gift to the world. What does John 3:16 and 17 say? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Now think of that principle. I know that most of us, if we're raised in the church, we know this verse. It's not a really hard thing to even quote. But what significance does it have that the creator of the universe sent his only begotten son to redeem those who reject the very one who created them? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, and that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And the part where unity comes in with more expression in this John 3:16 and 17 is the church sometimes maintains such a position of the judgment of God that we turn people off toward God. But verse 17 says, God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world. Jesus did not come to be our judge. He came to be our Savior. But that the world might be saved through him, the scripture says. That unity then, that the Son would surrender to the wishes of the Father in the Godhead, the unity of believers among one another is a demonstration of the unity of God, and it convinces people, according to what we read in Jesus' prayer, it convinces people that God did indeed send a Savior, his Son, to redeem people from their sins. So then you have to ask the question, I have to ask the question, what's the opposite of that? If believers struggle and don't have unity, what are we demonstrating to the world? If the church lived and loved in unity, I dare say we would not have as many denominations and different church groups that we have today. Because so many of the new denominations and so many of the new church groups are created because somebody's mad at somebody else and takes a small fraction of them and says, let's go start our own work. Has nothing really to do with doctrine, maybe theology, mostly it's just personality. But we would have many more local congregations united together in fulfilling the great commandment and the great commission of Jesus Christ. I'll give you an example of that. Two men meet on a bridge as they're walking, and they begin striking up a conversation. And one says to the other, are you a Christian? And the other guy says, yes, I am, but I identify as a born-again Christian. And the first guy goes, well, that's what I am too, a born-again Christian. What denomination are you? The one asks. And the other one says, well, I'm Southern Baptist. Really? I'm Southern Baptist too, says the second person. Are you Calvin Baptist or Arminian Baptist? And he says, well, I'm Calvin Baptist. So am I, brother. And they're having a great time. So let me ask you, are you pre-trib or post-trib in your eschatology? And the man says, I'm pre-trib. And the guy says to him, wow, this is terrific. I'm Southern Baptist, Indiana branch, just like you. And he says, no, I'm Southern Baptist, Kentucky branch. You heretic! And throws him off the bridge. Obviously that's a joke. I hope you saw it as a joke. But this is what the church can do to one another because of theology or just personal preference. What is the cause of church splits? Why do Christian churches divide? Though sometimes it's honorable and they're taking people, hiving them off to start another church in another location so the gospel might be reached into a broader base. Awesome. But unfortunately, so many times what happens is people leave a church and they go to another church, or they go start their own work, or they don't go to church at all anymore because it's more convenient for them. According to a website called gotquestions.org, it says this: the visions that lead to church splits are sad and all too common occurrence in the body of Christ. The causes of divisions in church are many, but ultimately the main reason for a church split is that someone has taken his focus off of Jesus Christ and began to use the church organization for his or her own ends. The church is more than an is to be more than an organization. The church is supposed to be an organism, a living thing, that than just an organization, a mechanical business kind of surrounding. The Apostle Paul uses the analogy of the body to describe the church in 1 Corinthians 12 and in Romans 12. He calls the church the body of Christ. However, we are to be the body which does the will of the head, and the head of the church is Jesus Christ. If everyone is in the body is focused on doing the will of God and on worshiping Jesus Christ in love and humility, there then may be disagreement, but the disagreement will be worked out in a fashion that honors the head, honors our Savior, in a loving and appropriate manner. You and I both know this church has a 97-year history, and you and I both know our local church just by itself has had many church divisions and arguments and splits. None of those, I would say, and I don't know the entire history, so I can't say 100%, but I would say the majority of those are not based upon someone's trying to violate doctrine. It's because someone didn't like what somebody else said, or someone chose a different color carpet than the other person wanted, or something as ridiculous as that. And the scripture says, when we demonstrate unity, we demonstrate to the world and convince the world that God sent Jesus to be Savior. So the opposite is, if we don't demonstrate unity, the world is rejecting God because it doesn't believe that he's real, because the believers who say they love him can't even get along. How big of an impression is that? Now, I'm really glad I'm sharing this when we're getting along, and not because we're not getting along. Obviously, I'd hate to bring this up if the church was actually split right now and we're going through a fight. We're not. But we need to be reminded of God's truth. Jesus prays that we would receive, not only that we would live in unity, but he goes on to pray that we would live in his glory. He says this in verse 22, the glory, talking to God now, the Father, the glory which you have given me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory which you have given to me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, although the world has not known you, yet I have known you, and these have known that you sent me, and I have made your name known to them, and will make it known so that the love which you loved me may be in them and I in them. Does that not excite you? That Jesus prays for us. By the way, he's still called our intercessor. He still prays for us. He talks to the Father for us. But Jesus prays here to God the Father is that glory would be like union. This is what glory is. He says, I pray that the glory which you have given me, I now am giving them. It's one thing to get his salvation. We need that. Without that, we get nothing else. But once we receive the salvation of Jesus Christ, now Jesus prays, I want them also to receive my glory. That is a like union. Not in nature, that we don't become gods, but rather in principle and purpose. What was the principle and the purpose of Jesus Christ? Jesus came that we might be redeemed from our sins. Jesus came that nobody would have to live under the judgment and wrath of God. Jesus came to redeem people from their sins. And he says, I'm giving that glory to my people. Those who follow me, they have the same principle. They have the same purpose. They are to fulfill the great command, which is to love God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and the great commission to go and be my witness wherever they are. They are united with the Godhead and united with one another, not pursuing different interests or counteracting each other's purposes, or forming parties, but seeking the same ends to the same means. We are all on this earth as followers of Jesus Christ. We are still here once we receive Christ because God has a divine commandment and commission for us to fulfill on His behalf. And He gives us spiritual gifts, and He gives us His glory. He calls us to live in unity. He says, walk in love with one another. The Father and the Son have always sought the same objectives. Never do we read in the Scriptures that God the Father says, this is what I want, and Jesus says, but I think this is better. Never. The Godhead has always been united on the direct same purposes. And Jesus says, you're my disciples. And so I'm praying that you get my glory. I'm praying that you are unified as we are unified. I'm praying that you will be a living example of the Godhead. And people will be convinced when you are that Jesus Christ came to redeem people from their sins. What an awesome privilege and awesome responsibility for us. Believers have the same love of the Father as Jesus does. That's what verse 25 and 6 said. Righteous Father, although the world has not known you, yet I have known you, and these have known that you sent me. And I have made your name known to them, and you will make it known so that the love with which you loved me may be in us, and I in them. Awesome privilege. And I don't know about your life. I can go flashback in the histories of my relationship with the Lord and my relationship with church people, and I can find some really good stories, and I can find some horrendous stories. Like, man, somebody's not listening to Jesus, or nobody's listening to Jesus because we're acting like the devil toward one another. You know, the sad thing is, in church conflict anyway, what I have noticed is that it's one thing to have disagreement, but normally if someone's disagreeing with another Christian, they use a Bible verse or they use the name of God to support their sinful nature. Now they don't call it sinful nature. They say, well, the Bible says this, and so therefore I'm right and you're wrong. And someone else says, yeah, but the Bible says this. And we're going now to theology, which is interpretations of certain verses, which are probably both cases out of context, perhaps. Because we want to win the battle, because we're not interested about Jesus anymore, we're interested about us. But we want to look religious, we want to look holy, so we grab a Bible verse to support our angst toward our brother or sister. And it breaks the heart of God. Because Jesus says, I'm praying that they receive my glory. I'm praying that they are unified in Jesus Christ. I'm praying that they demonstrate the love of God in the same manner that we see it in the Godhead. We should see it among the sisters and brothers of Jesus Christ. Note, by the way, that the union of His people occupied the mind of Jesus when He prayed this prayer. He was not that far away of dying, being put to death on the cross. And yet the thing that He prayed about was not, Lord, this is all about me, but Lord, this is about what's going to happen after I die and am resurrected. That the followers of me, that's what's on my heart right now, are those who are going to be the followers of Jesus Christ. The mission has always been the same. The great commandment found in Mark 12 and in Matthew also, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And I love that part that he takes two commandments and speaks of them as one. And then in that commandment, to loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we are loving others in the same time. Then he gives us the great commission. This is the expression of our love for God, by loving others so much that we go out to share the good news with them. And Jesus came and spoke to them, and saying in Matthew 28:18, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I'm not sending you out there by yourself. I'm with you every step of the way. Now, we know the church has internal and external issues of disunity from time to time. Matter of fact, I would love to, I could, I suppose we take attendance. I'd love to say, okay, if we ever have a church problem, and I'm going to go back to this message and go, remember when I said this? No, I'm not going to do that, because it's actually God saying this. But we need these truths to be ingrained in our heart, because there's a greater thing at work here than our comfort or our sense of this is the way it should be. It's all about Jesus. It's always been about Jesus. And yet Jesus in his love says, I'm going to give you my glory. I'm going to give you my unity. I'm going to give you my love, and I want you to use it in such an expression that it looks just like the Godhead, the unity and love and glory of God, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So how are splits and disagreements reconciled in the world? Because there will be probably times when that happens in church life. It'd be great if all of a sudden just quit, but I'm not that naive. Church splits are healed through repentance and humility. If there is a disagreement, the best would be for both sides to repent, for both sides repent of anything said or done in an unloving manner during the disagreement. By the way, probably should go without saying, but I'll say it anyway. There are times where you bite your tongue during the encounter, but then when you go home with your family or go home with your friends, you rail on it with them. That's what this is talking about. We have to repent of those kind of times. Repentance includes seeking forgiveness from the party offended by another's behavior, even if they don't ask for it. In humility, each should accept the other's apology, committing to go forward in the bonds of Christian love. And I want you to know something. I've been around the block, so have you. Sometimes the initial clash is so severe, when you go back to apologize, they don't take your apology. Or they tell you when you say, I really want to apologize, I really want to ask you to forgiveness. I could never forgive what you did. It was so bad. And inside, what do we want to do? Well, then nuts to you. I know that's what we feel like. But the Bible says, no, don't go there. Keep loving that person, praying for reconciliation. Because the enemy is the one that wins. The devil wins in this. It isn't us that wins. We might win an argument. What we never win, unless we're honoring God, we can do that as an individual, even if the person that we have offended or they perceive we offended doesn't accept our repentance and forgiveness. In humility, each should accept the other's apology. And the only one we can look to in the situations of reconciliation is us. How am I going to respond to this? Because if I decide to act according to my human sinful nature, there will never be reconciliation. I must do my part and leave the rest with the Lord. So number one, we're perfected in unity in this manner. Right now, we get to come pretty soon to communion together, and you've already got all the elements. And this is a chance the scripture talks about, examine yourself before the Lord, and it might be there was something in your past or something in my past, or there might be something in the present where you know you are acting in a fashion that is not glorifying to God, and you have to ask God, Lord, help me to love even though that person is unlovable. Listen, I've been there. I've been in situations where the people I'm praying for, when God says pray for them, what I want to pray is, God, take them out. Be like the Old Testament prayers where, God, my enemies, please remove them from the face of the earth. That's the prayer I want to pray. But God says, no, you must demonstrate love. And so, Lord, you must. I pray that you will help them to discover the love of God. If they are being overwhelmed by Satan's tools, that they would understand your mercy. Because when we start praying blessing over people, even though they're people that offend us, what happens is God begins to change our heart from the inside out. And only God can do that. Even if we don't feel it during those prayers, don't let your emotions dictate when you're going to pray for someone's blessing. If you're waiting for your emotions to lead the way, they're going to lie to you. Don't listen to your emotions. Listen to the foundational truths, the doctrines of Jesus Christ. It says, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love one another. God will bring the emotions up to par as you begin to pray blessing over others. The love of God is manifested through unity. So we want to demonstrate with other believers unity. If we follow that up, and we might, sometimes on purpose, well, not on purpose, but knee-jerk on purpose, sometimes we do it, we don't even realize we've done it. We said something to someone, and it has just, and we don't know it, but they're really offended. But when we found out, we need to go to them and say, look, we need to make this right for the glory of God. Number three, the world sees and believes God sent his only begotten Son through the unity of the saints. So if we truly want to love and honor God, we will do everything in our ability through the power of Jesus Christ to love others, even when they appear to be unlovable. Because you know what? God still loves them. Think about the most vile person you've ever met or even read about throughout history. And remember that God loved that person. It was God's greatest desire that that person would be redeemed from their sins, would repent of those sins, and they would discover the joy of the salvation of Jesus Christ. That's God's desire for even the most wicked and evil person. And that's the kind of love he wants us to have for others. The world understands the love of God is as strong for his human creation as it is for his Son when we live in Christian unity. Let me say that again. The world understands the love of God is as strong for his human creation as it is for his Son when we are truly living in unity of faith in Jesus Christ. And finally, number five, the completion of the great commandment, love God and others, and the completion of the Great Commission, be his witness, is found in unity and glory of the church as given to us by the Godhead. We are so blessed, so gifted, so loved by a merciful and loving Heavenly Father that when we fail him in this unity thing, he doesn't judge us and abandon us. He wants to bring us back. He will pursue us, but he wants us to understand the joy of his love and his unity and his mercy and his righteousness so that that can be expressed and experienced by all people who will repent and seek God's forgiveness. Well, today we have the privilege of taking communion together. For the first time in a long time. We did this electronically on Easter. It was great. It was great with God, but you weren't there in the human form. And this is awesome to have you all together. As a church, what better way to talk about unity than to have the unity of the faith around the communion table as a family? So celebrating corporately and individually our salvation in Jesus Christ. But before we do, we are always cautioned by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11 to examine ourselves. So I don't want to be presumptuous, because the Scripture says we are to examine ourselves. If we do not do it correctly, the Holy Spirit will do it. And then as a result, some of you will be sickly and some of you will even die. That's right out of Corinthians. So we have the opportunity to examine ourselves. But we come to the communion table, we don't do it just because it's a church activity. We do it because God said, do this in remembrance of me. Keep this going to remind you of my love and my sacrifice for you and to remind you of your salvation and what it means. So the first step, I don't want to be presumptuous, is that everyone here is a believer. I look around and I kind of think, they probably are. But I don't want to make a mistake and just believe that and then someone's not. So the first thing is, if you want to take communion elements, and I hope that you do, we have to make sure that we're part of the family of God. And of course, that comes through confession. We confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead. We ask Christ to forgive us of our sins and repent of those sins so we don't go back there. And God says, welcome into the family of God. Okay? So that's the first part. If you've never asked Christ to forgive you of your sins and asked him to be your Savior, that is the first step. Now, you can do that here, not to take the communion elements, although you can take them after you do that, but you can do that here so that you know that you are part of God's family, now and for all eternity. And it's a simple prayer, and we'll grant prayer in a moment, but you can just pray simply, God, I understand it. I get it. I'm a person born into sin, and I have denied you at times, and I just ask you to forgive me now, cleanse me from all that, and I ask you to be my Savior. I surrender to you to be the Savior and Lord of my life. Once you make that prayer, if it's sincere, God's there and has forgiven you. It's that simple. But then the scripture says, work out your salvation. It doesn't mean you work to be more saved. It just means now we begin to follow God's plan the rest of our life. And part of that I just spelled out this morning. But once you become a part of the family of God, you are welcome to take the elements. And by the way, if you ask God today to forgive you of all your sins, you're ready to take the elements. Don't feel like you're unworthy. God makes you worthy because Christ is in you. Now, if you are already a believer and you came in this morning, you thought you had it nailed down and you're ready to take communion, and the Holy Spirit now is knocking on your heart's door saying, hey, wait a minute, remember that person that you don't like or that event or whatever it is? You need to forgive that person, or you need to go to that person. So I'm going to say this. You all hopefully received the elements when you walked in this morning. If you didn't and you want some, raise your hand and we'll get them for you on the back table back there. But don't take the elements and say, Lord, I'm going to do this later. The Bible tells us that if we come to the altar and we have something against another person, leave your sacrifice at the altar and go and make things right. Don't do it the other way around. Now, that's God's word. Therefore, I just want to caution you, as much as you may be here today and you're thinking, I want to take communion, if God's speaking to you, not me, but if the Holy Spirit now is speaking to you about something, about unity, or something about something else in your life, and you know that that should be dealt with and you can't deal with it at the moment, just through prayer, that God's saying you need to go do something else, then leave the elements for today. You can put it in your pocket. Take it home, and then when you do it, then you have communion. But understand, this is a very important thing to God, that we do not take the elements lightly, that we examine ourselves, and then the freedom to take the elements, because we know that God, we have followed his plan. We're not responsible for what the other person, how they respond or how they act. It's not that you have to make this right with that person. If you do your best and you leave it before the throne of God, God will let you take communion. But the point is that God wants us to at least take the effort that he spelled out to us in the scriptures. And that's what I want to leave with you as we come to the table of the Lord. So we're going to do a little bit differently this morning. I'm going to have a word of prayer in a second, but again, I want to give you the instructions so that you don't have juice all over your lap. Okay? So these are not gluten-free. I need to make that announcement again, and I apologize. That's how they came. They're pre-matched. Do not pull up the pointy tip until you have peeled off the thin see-through layer on top. You can pull it off, and then you have the wafer underneath that. You can take the wafer off. Then when I give you instructions, you can grab the pointy tip and peel that back, and now the juice is exposed. If you pull back the pointy part first, now you have the juice exposed, and you got to figure out how to get the wafer out. That's a little bit more difficult. Okay? So I'm going to encourage you, if you haven't peeled back the thin part and got the wafer, get that out in a moment, okay? I'm going to have a prayer. And then we're going to have some music playing as we take communion. Now, my microphone is still going to be on, so I'm going to instruct you when to take the wafer and when to take the cup as this is playing. So you just have to kind of hear it through there. But this is how we're going to have communion today. and then we'll have a prayer once the song is over, and then we'll have the intermission video if anybody feels they need to leave before we do the singing aspect. But as we get started, let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your justice, your commandments. Thank you that you don't let us run without pursuing us. You love us. Thank you for challenging us, Lord, sometimes when we don't want to be challenged. And thank you, Lord, for clarifying through your divine Holy Spirit what we should be about and how we should act as followers of Jesus Christ. Lord, if there is anyone this morning that has prayed what we call the sinner's prayer, I know because of your word that you've heard it and you have welcomed that person into the family of God. Hallelujah, Father. And if that has happened here or happens because of the result of the live feed, then Lord, I pray those people will let someone know that's a believer and they can begin to grow and rejoice with others about being part of the family of God. Father, I pray for us who are going to examine ourselves this morning based upon what we heard before we take the elements. Let us, Lord, listen with an attentive ear and not try to gloss over in the event that you're pounding and we know that what you're going to say and we don't want to hear it. Let us be right with you as we rejoice at your table and celebrate the goodness of God in Jesus Christ. Be blessed and make us a blessing as we receive the blessing of God through communion this morning. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So as the music's playing, hopefully if you haven't gotten this off yet, you need to take that off. But I also want to encourage you, if you haven't taken a moment to examine yourself, do that right now. I guarantee, by the way, if you start praying, saying, okay, Spirit, speak, is there anything? He will if you stop and listen. It's just, he's very good at that. This plays, I'm going to have you shut off the lights, Lonnie, if you could, too, so people can see this video. And then I'll instruct you when to eat the wafer and when to drink the juice. So if you've taken the bread out already and you want to prepare the juice, you're welcome to do that as we eat and drink together. Go ahead and start the feed, if you would.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one.
By our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love, they'll know us by. Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So when you leave this morning, whether it's now during the intermission or after we're done singing, by the table where the cups were placed, there's also a garbage can. Could you just deposit your communion cup in the garbage can on your way out? By the way, again, if there's an offering, you can put it. There's a deposit place by the door on your way out. If you brought an offering today, you can put it in that offering box. So at this time, we're going to have another video. And this one talks about our country and just thanks the Lord for the country we live in. It is during this time, if you feel that you need to leave before we start singing, please stand and our ushers will escort you out so that we don't bottleneck in the entryway. If you want to greet someone when you're out there, please do it outside in the parking lot. Thank you so much for coming if you have to leave now. And let's play this next video, please. We'll be right back. Amen. That great. So we're going to sing a few songs together. Some of them will be patriotic in nature, but we always want to focus on our God. Our country is good, but God is great. And so we want to ask God to be blessing our country, especially now during this time of upheaval. And so we're going to start with God Bless America, kind of sing that as a prayer. If you want to stand, you are welcome to. If you feel you cannot, then that's fine. Please have a seat. But let's sing together our first song. Father, we do ask for your blessing. We need it desperately. The scriptures do tell us, Heavenly Father, that if your people who are humbled by your name will humble themselves, if your people will humble themselves, then, and we seek God, seek your face, that you will heal the land. It's not those that don't know you who is responsible. It's not those even who are in politics who are responsible. It's the people of God. And if we will humble ourselves and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways, you promise to heal our land. Lord, heal our land. Come, Lord Jesus, as that mighty King, and bring victory through our country so that there's peace again and love to one another. I just pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
Amen. Father God, your truth is marching on. I want to pray for you a prayer that is recorded by Nehemiah in Nehemiah chapter 1. God, God of heaven, the great and awesome God, loyal to his covenant, thank you, and faithful to those who love you and obey your commandments. Lord, look at me, look at us, look at our nation, Lord. Listen, please. Pay attention to the prayer of your servant and your servants that I'm praying in intercession for us, the people of Hibbing, the people of the United States, and ultimately, Lord, the people of the world. We are confessing the sins of the people, Lord, of Hibbing in America. We are experiencing today in our country that which we have actually created ourselves. And I'm including myself in this prayer. I and my ancestors, among those who have sinned against you. We've treated you, O Father, like dirt. We haven't done what you told us to do, haven't followed your commands, O God, haven't respected the decisions that you gave to us from the time of Adam and Eve until now. All the same, please remember the warning you posted to your servant Moses that if we betray you, you will scatter us to the four winds. But if we come back to you, that you will receive us, that you will gather us up like scattered peoples from wherever we ended up and put us back in the place that you chose to mark with your name. That is your mercy. Thank you. Well, here we are, your servants, your people, whom you so powerfully and impressively redeemed. Oh, Master, please listen to me and to us. Listen to your servant's prayer. And yes, to all your servants who delight in honoring you, please forgive us for our inactivity. Forgive us when we sin against you. Waken us to the idea and the concept that you have called us to be your witnesses. So use us and preserve us for your glory. I pray in Jesus' name that you, God, would build in us this collective of unity and glory that, Jesus, you prayed over us so that we would indeed be a family of God that would lead other people to Jesus Christ. I pray in your name. Amen. Father. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. Thank you, God, for speaking to us, for challenging us, for calling us constantly back into your presence. Oh, God, thank you so much for this time we spent together as a family of God. And I just pray, Lord, this week that if there is reconciliation that has to be done, that we will not hesitate, we will not forget, but we will pursue as you pursue us for the glory of our God and Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you please be so kind as to wait till an usher can escort you out so we don't bottleneck in the entryway? Thank you.